Welcome to the World United.
Welcome to the World United.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hi, this is Harrison Klein with the World United and the Third World Parliament on Spirituality. I want to get a really, really significant opportunity here to play with one of my favorite business people on the planet. So we have an interview with Jaffery Hayzlet here. He is a global celebrity. He's been on primetime TV. He has had shows on primetime TV, on podcast hosts. He's an author of, is it four New York Times bestseller. He's a keynote speaker, former chief marketing officer of Kodak. He's the CEO of the C-Suite Network and also a very special place called the Heroes Club. And today we're going to talk about spirituality and business. And he's got some really great information for you. So the Hero Club is the sort of elite factor for people who are heroically connected to the world and giving back and doing great things. And that's a spiritual principle. So what does the hero leader mean, Jaffery?
Well, you know, no one wakes up every morning, Harrison, and says, oh, I can't wait to be a hero. I know that we dream when we were kids we might be heroes. But, you know, hero is all about recognizing those kinds of businesses that do things for the right reasons. I mean, that's really, truly what it is. A number of years ago, the group was started by a guy by the name of Rob Ryan, who sold his business for $4 billion, if I want to be exact. And back when he sold it, he set aside a percentage of the company for all of his employees, making the single largest number of millionaires ever created in one day. His employees would go up to him at lunch, dinner, wherever he was at, and say, hey, Mr. Ryan, you don't know me, but I'm the night watchman, and I can send my kids to college. You're my hero. Or they'd run up to his wife, Terry, who was the chief legal officer at the time, and say, Mrs. Ryan, I'm the janitor, and my mother-in-law has cancer, and she doesn't have life or health insurance, and I'm going to pay for the operation. She's going to live. You're our hero, you know? And they didn't feel like heroes. So what they decided to do was get together with a number of people and create a mastermind. That's really, truly what it is, a council of peers to really get together and come together and talk about values in business, how to put people over profit. And the result was that these businesses grossed more dollars than anyone else. They made more money than anyone else in their category or industry. They had happier employees and customers who were more engaged and vendors who wanted to do business with them. And, you know, when they walked through the community, and you've seen this in your time in business, that people would go, oh, there goes so-and-so with such and such. And those were the kind of businesses that people revere. And so they decided to do that. And they did this for a number of years. And then came to me after a number of those years and said, hey, what you're doing with the C-Suite Network is huge. Can we put it together with you guys? And they basically said, give me a dollar. And I gave them a dollar and we bought the Hero Club. And we've been turning it into a bigger organization every since then. And so the hero is a recognition of those businesses that put people above profit, that do things for the right reason, that take care of their community, the little league, the symphony, the environment, you know, doing the right things. And that's really, really critical to be a hero business.
And we talk about values and what we just discussed, basically, but it's all that we all consider that part of spirituality, right? Would you consider that?
So what is this? It's a key component. You know, it's a very key component for a lot of people.
Yeah, and how does that basically work? What is the spirituality aspect of that for people?
Well, you know, in all of us, we have to have a different level. You know, my friend years ago, Stephen Covey, if you remember Stephen Covey, I used to be on stage with Stephen decades ago. And when we were on stage, one thing that struck me when he talked about 7 habits of highly effective people, he said, you have to have 4 things in life. You have to have a relationship with your family, your friends, your business, and your spirituality. You know, yeah. You have to have that in order to be very balanced. I mean, think of, you know, when we were kids, you remember that 4-way teeter-totter we used to ride? Harrison, you probably still play on it. I imagine you probably still do.
And both sides.
And usually most teeter-totters like this are like this, but this 4-way, and that's what it reminds me of these 4 key components. And spirituality is one of those. And if you get out of whack there, it gets you out of whack a lot of ways. You know, I live in the middle of South Dakota. I love South Dakota, and I live in the middle of the United States. And South Dakota is a very spiritual place for me. It's a very spiritual geography. I get grounded here. And to me, it's a centering piece of my life. And for a lot of business leaders, especially executives, they have to have something that grounds them, something that kind of guides them and holds them to the center of where they should be.
And you know, what actually put you on the hero's journey a long time ago? I mean, you know, you've been on this obviously for many, many, many years, because that's integral to who you are. So what actually was the impetus and the experience that put you on the hero's journey?
Probably pain, you know, pain. I mean, if it's like when you're a little kid, you learn that the stove is hot, you learn by touching it. And I think we learn, you know, all the other things in our business that get out of whack, or we get out of whack when we're not centered. You know, I spent a lot of time over in Asia in my earlier career, in my 30s, early 30s, where I spent a great deal of time in Japan and China and Korea and so doing a lot of business. And so that was a big influence for me. It was a big influence to experience other religions and other culture and in such a way that it just really calmed me in a number of ways. I call it the spiritual side of that business. And so I learned very quickly that when I wasn't practicing certain kinds of things of being more centered in my life or more spiritual, I was having a difficult time. And so that's what I say the pain usually causes that.
No, there's so much epic literature on being a hero. There is the hero's journey that Joseph Campbell described most recently in his mythology books, and then there's also the great experiences of, you know, the Buddha and Hermann Hesse, and all the great artists have some form of talking about a hero's journey, where it starts in which you leave home, you are dissatisfied with all the things that happen in your life, and so you are seeking a new environment, a new culture, a new beingness. And that new beingness leads to a bunch of adversity because you're not in any way or shape connected to the old one, and you don't yet know the new one. So you're in a state of adversity. And then as you discover and as you become competent within the unknown portion of that, you open yourself up to flower into greater, bigger, heroic type things. So that's the story of the hero's journey. It's a first a convergence and then an openness. So what transpires in your effect? What core principles makes a spiritual leader?
Well, to me, I you just said one of them right there, awareness, in terms of, you know, I live in a constant state of I'm not aware of what I'm not aware of. And so I try not to take too many. What's that?
That's a good opening. That's
well, it that is because right there's question. So many things that you know that I'm taught every day, right? Or I say it, it's going to be like this, or it's like this, and usually it turns out no, it's like this. Okay, so I try not to do that too many times. There are some things, maybe little things, that I kind of stick to, but most of the things that are big, I try to listen and observe and take it in. And then from there, understand how I can act. And I act fairly quickly because of the experiences I've had. But that's one. The you know, I said values earlier, your core values of what you are, who you are, you know, and to be self-assured about those values. I mean, that doesn't mean they can't change or evolve over time, but to be self-assured or grounded in them, I think is pretty critical. And the third part that I like, Harrison, is I practice what I call conditions of satisfaction. And it's a very simple thing. What do I want out of life? What do I want out of relationships? What do I want out of working with you? And I try to shore those up pretty quick, because that way I at the end of our transaction, at the end of our interaction, and in the middle of our friendship, I can be satisfied. And so to me, those mutual conditions of satisfaction are pretty critical in my relationship. So you know, it's like, you know, it's down to the simple things. Like my wife will say, where do you want to go for dinner? And I tell her and I right away. And she goes, well, you didn't think about all these other places. I say, well, yes, I did. This my condition of satisfaction is I want to go there. I know what I want. And so that's okay to have. And so that's a core piece of who I am or what I do.
And part of the business is to put yourself into the unknown and allow yourself to listen, allow yourself to learn, because as you learn the processes, that spirituality becomes much more a connection between you and your environment and the people around you and so on and so forth. So how does leadership and culture come together in this aspect of spirituality?
Well, culture evolves over a very long time, and culture is made up by the goods and the bads of all of us, meaning all together. And, you know, back in my days when I was the chief marketing officer of Eastman Kodak, I would say, you're Kodak, I'm Kodak, she's Kodak, he's Kodak, we're all Kodak, whatever that means. And for each of us, it means something a little bit different, but at the core of who we are and those values, that's the core of what we are. And then we each put our own little like covering or little force field around that. That becomes our own kind of environment for the culture that we're in. But that the core of that is to make sure that we're always leading to something. And so I think the values that we all share today, 53% of the people who work for companies don't know the values of their company. Well, I can tell you what the culture of the company is going to be if that's the case. It's not going to be very good. If you don't know, if a majority of the people who are working for you don't know your values, don't live them, don't eat, sleep, drink the Kool-Aid of the values every single day, you're going to have a really screwed up organization and a culture that's never going to work.
Now, we don't recognize that everything in the universe is going someplace, always. And we have to find out where that is when we're involved, you know. So we want to push the envelope. And what makes these things plausible? What is it that makes these things plausible to find out where you're going and what you're doing? And how do we get the decisions to for the preferences of where we want to go and what we want to do?
Well, I think it's a human nature that nobody wakes up every morning and says, I can't wait to be stupid. You know, there are things, environment and things that kind of force us to be stupid or to do stupid things. But, you know, maybe that's drugs, maybe that's drinking, maybe that's a lot of different things, you know, maybe it's the way you were treated when you were a kid. And so I think most of us strive to be a better person. I think almost everyone, there are those people who, a few people who are not, but for the most part, everybody is. So I think it's that unique nature of being human, to discover new things, to take us to new places that we've never been. And I think in, you know, and whatever your religion, whatever your beliefs, I think we all try to go to a different level in life. And I think that's what makes us pretty unique, unlike other animals on this earth.
Right. The other animals don't have ambition and they don't have things that they need to accomplish. But the beautiful thing is that you've always been known as somebody who challenges the status quo, you know, and that's a pretty awesome place to be, because it is one of the genius factors of life. You know, the geniuses are the ones who challenge the status quo in order to make something new and different and better. And that's the evolution process. So let's talk a little bit about that. So, you know, there is a level of creation that comes through, you know, pushing the envelope. So talk about what that is. How, you know, have you met any resistance with that? What's the story behind all that? And how do you experience that in this world?
People right now, especially with COVID, are talking about, you know, the new normal. And I'm going like, when's it ever been normal? I've never known it to be normal. It's just that's different. And it just happens to affect us all. For my life, it's always been that way. For me, it's always been wanting to do something, you know, in a better way, whatever that is, and to find out, why does it have to be that way? Or why do we accept things that we don't want? If we want this other piece, if we want to go here, why do we say we can't get there because we don't have enough gas? Okay, well, let's go get some more gas. Well, we don't have any money. Well, let's go get some money. Well, Jeff, we don't have a car. Okay, well, then we're going to have to walk. Okay, forget the gas. Now we'll walk. How far is it? Oh, 1,000 miles. That's going to take a while. We better plan it out. You know, so that's kind of my nature of being able to say, if we're going to go get there, we're going to go there, then let's figure it out. But, and I also just have the desire to want to go there. All right. Not in everything. There are some things that I'm perfectly happy with. I don't challenge the status quo of scotch, for instance. I think scotch's perfect. I don't think you can change it. You shouldn't change it. I think it's perfect. Don't mess with it. So there are certain things in life that I find to be very good. When once you get to that level, I just need to drink more of it. That's my life. That's what I would like to be able to do. So that's challenging my status quo. Why can't I have more than two or three, you know? But nonetheless, I work on that perfection every single day. And I just think that's just a desire that you have to have inside of yourself to want to go and do you know, something and make it better. And that gets into a servant, what I call a servant mentality of serving others and doing things for other people. You know, you know, at the C-Suite Network, one of my tenets is the more you give, the more you get. And if we give in life, there's universal law of giving. If we more we give in life, the more things come back to us. I have found that to be true. And so I go out of my way to see what I can do to help people. And, you know, not that it's always out of my way, but I do things for other people. Why? With no, and by the way, no intention that's going to come back to me. I know it will come. It will. I know it will, because experience tells me it will, but I don't expect.
That's just the law of the universe. It's a boomerang universe. What you put out, you get back plus. So,
Well, you know, it's just like, look, every morning I get up early in the morning. I fix my coffee. I get my wife's coffee ready. If she wants a little breakfast, I get it ready for her. I do things like that. I don't have to do that. She doesn't ask me to do that. Some days I think she would prefer that I don't do that. All right. So we kind of come to a combination of the things I do, but it makes me feel better in doing that for her. And I'm vice versa. She does things for me. Well, why can't we do that in business? Why can't we do that as human beings? Why can't we do that as friends or fathers or brothers or sisters? It makes us a much better place.
The best among us do that. So, you know, the spiritual principle behind that is the greatest among you is always a servant of all, you know, so that's a basic tenet. So, and when we do these things, oftentimes, have you found that you come up against resistance?
Oh, totally. All the time. Yeah. Like, why are you doing this? Or distrust or surprise. Either, you know, there's many emotions that come with that, many, many reasons for that. But that's okay. You just, you know, just sometimes you have to remind people, I'm not doing it for you. I'm doing it for me.
Right. And then, there are people out there who think anybody can be a leader or anybody can serve and all that. Tell me a little bit about where do you stand on leadership and having to do, you know, with making a difference in people's lives and making a difference in business and spirituality.
Everybody can be a leader. You might not be good at it or can't do it all. That maybe you can't sustain it for long periods of times, but everybody can be a leader. I mean, in our team meetings of our team, we have introverts, and you can imagine we have extroverts, right? We have all aspects of personality. And so when we're sitting on a team meeting today on Zoom, and there's, you know, 25, 40 people on the screen, well, not everybody likes to talk. Well, what we do is we trade that around and put different people in charge of our team meeting every single week, twice a week. We have different people. Everybody's taking a turn. And it's great to watch those introverts, those that would never talk, come forward. And we make a point to make sure that everybody is called out on the meeting. And the reason for that is that everyone has a voice and everyone should contribute. And what we do is we find leadership in different places in different ways. Now, it doesn't mean there are certain ones of us that raise our hand every time or jump in right away, because that's what good people do. Or that's what leaders do. And there are others who just, you know, have done it more. It's more in tune to their psyche. It's more in tune to their core of who they are. So that doesn't mean anyone else is less of a leader. Everybody has something to contribute. Everybody can lead in something. Just not might be the thing you're doing right there.
And leadership evokes a response from other people. The best leaderships are getting, you know, great things with other people and, you know, through other people as well. So there's a great connection there to oftentimes the ones who are silent run deep. And though they don't, you know, they may not speak as often, but they have things to say that are really sometimes very profound and oftentimes more profound than the ones who want to jump in and talk.
Totally.
So, you know, I just wanted to give the people a small preview of who you are and what you're going to be talking about when we come on to the World United platform in December, I believe. And we're going to have an incredible opportunity to spend some time with you for an hour and, you know, really get to know the whole connection between human beings, leadership principles, business, and spirituality, because I think it's something that everybody needs to know. And especially at this time, we have to become more entrepreneurial, or more spiritual, more connected to what is going on. And as we open up ourselves and take this hero's journey, take this journey of discovery and life and love, you know, we're going to unite people into a unity type consciousness where everybody is included instead of everybody being, you know, categorized. So we appreciate that. Thank you, Jaffery, for coming on. Any parting words for our people?
I'm looking forward to it. Let's make a difference. So I'm looking forward to it.
We're intending to have 100 million people in December. So awesome. And life is good. So I appreciate you coming on today, Jaffery. It's an awesome thing to do.
My pleasure. My pleasure.
We will catch up with you on your date. What was the date you had again?
I believe, oh my gosh. November 23rd, 3 p.m. Eastern time.
Put that on your calendars, guys, okay? All right, so this is Harrison Klein and Jaffery Hayzlet saying till next time.
Cheers.